Thank you, section leaders, and good morning. Welcome to University Baptist Church on this 16th Sunday after Pentecost, September 20th, 2020. For anyone watching who doesn't know me, my name is David Tomasacci, and I'm the director of music here at University Baptist Church. At any time, you can pause and check out this video's description to see listed there today's worship order, leaders, and musicians. I'll also take this moment to invite each of you to join along in singing our Approaching God hymn, the Doxology, and our Postlude. Our introit this morning was the hymn, Help Us Accept Each Other. The words of this hymn were written by Fred Kahn, and the music for this setting was written by John Nesbeck, former minister of music here at University Baptist Church. Our message in music this morning is Precious Lord, Take My Hand, written by Thomas Andrew Dorsey and sung by the UBC Choir in November of 2018. This moving hymn has a long history with the civil rights movement in the United States. It was reportedly Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s favorite hymn, and on April 4th, 1968, the day of his assassination, he asked blues saxophonist Ben Branch to, quote, play that song tonight. I want you to play it like you've never played it before in your life. For today's message of anti-racism and opposing oppression, I chose this hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand, not only to tie our thoughts back to the civil rights movement and to remind us that we still, over 50 years later, have so very far to go and have so much yet to do to help bring Dr. King's dream into waking reality, but to offer a word of comfort and support to all those who in this fight may be feeling tired, weak, and worn. Thomas Andrew Dorsey, the composer of Precious Lord, is the father of gospel music in the United States. He was already a prodigious and leading figure in blues and jazz and the architect of gospel music when his wife, Nettie Harper, died in childbirth along with their child. What followed was a long battle with depression, inconsolable bereavement, and a personal vow never to sing again. But with time, prayer, and support from friends and loved ones, Dorsey began to compose, Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. And now I invite you all to rise in your spirits, to learn to accept each other as Christ accepted you, to let the precious and loving Lord take your hand and lead you through the storm, and to join us in worship. Welcome to University Baptist Church.
Hello. I'm Ken Watkins. I'm the Associate Pastor of University Baptist Church, Columbus, Ohio. I want to add my greetings to the greetings of others who are part of this virtual service. Today, University Baptist joins other churches that are part of the Ohio Council of Churches to emphasize anti-racism. This is not a new emphasis for University Baptist Church. In fact, University Baptist Church was one of the first American Baptist churches to be integrated in the Columbus area. When I think about our church and I try to describe it to others, sometimes I want to say, oh yes, we're fully integrated. But then when I realize that implies that we are a white church that allows people of other races and ethnicities to be a part of, I think a better description is that we are a multiracial church. We are a church where races come together, a variety of cultures come together, and all of it, in our coming together, we shape this church. Now, our preacher today is Beth Short. And as I think about Beth's preaching, I always look forward to her confessional nature. And when I think about others who preach in our church, people generally, the preachers whom we usually, and we have a variety of people who preach, our preachers share from their hearts and they share from their lives. Not only do they share from scriptures, but they bring scriptures and life experience and where they are presently together and offer it to us. Let's anticipate God's touching our hearts, speaking to us, leading us, showing us who we are, and showing us who others are, and showing us God's love for all of us.
Hey, I'm Jasmine.
Hey, I'm Christina.
And we're going to do the call to worship today.
Okay. We come to you, O God, as vulnerable human beings who are yearning to be faithful. We pray for courage. We pray for strength during a time of great upheaval in our country and world.
Awaken us, O God.
Open our eyes so we can truly see you and one another. Guide us beyond any numbing of spirit that keeps us from acknowledging the sacredness and worthiness of all humanity.
Awaken us, O God.
Wash away our weariness so we can find renewed sustenance for the journey as we witness what harm has been caused by the sin of racism.
Awaken us, O God.
Bring forth in us a desire to put down our old ways of being. Ways that may have at times brought hurt and distance between and among your people.
Inspire us, O God.
Help us hear wisdom from those impacted by racism. Stories having the power to transform us and make us more loving.
Inspire us, O God.
Put us where we need to be in our daily lives so we can receive insight and truth.
Inspire us, O God.
Remove any shackles, any blinders, so we can move forward knowing you, O God. Walk with us and sustain us in our path toward healing.
Empower us, O God.
We call upon you, our inner fortitude, to give us the resilience to challenge oppressive systems that keep your children in bondage.
Empower us, O God.
May we seek others who, too, are yearning to establish a more perfect union. One steeped in loving kindness and forgiveness woven with strands of hope and acceptance.
Empower us, O God.
In the words of Martin Luther King Jr., let us claim the urgency of now as we act with vigilance and confidence, marching against racism and towards justice.
Engage us, O God.
Linking hands, we challenge white privilege, raise our voices in protest and concern, write our legislators, vote our ballots. Always reaffirming that acts of advocacy are vital if love is to prevail.
Engage us, O God.
A powerful wind is blowing. The beloved community is possible. The beloved community will come with you by our side as co-creators for reconciliation and peace. Give us the stamina required until the day arrives.
Engage us, O God. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our cyber service here at University Baptist Church. Our first scripture reading this morning is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Encourage the oppressed. Defend the cause of the fatherless and plead the case of the widow. Our second scripture is from the book of Amos, chapter 5, verse 24. But let justice roll on like a river, and righteousness like a never-failing stream. And then finally, from the book of Micah, chapter 6, verse 8. God has shown all of us what is good, and what does the Lord require of us? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word.
Thank you. Hi, friends. My name is Beth Short. Thank you for joining us today. You know, today is noted as Anti-Racism Sunday in churches all across Ohio. So on this day, I wanted to provide testimony about my feelings, my confessions, and my commitment as it relates to anti-racism. Have you ever had one of those friends who, every time you start talking about something that you might be concerned about or excited about, somehow they've already had that same experience? They already know about it, and they're happy to tell you about it. So maybe I'm excited about getting a brand new Ford Escort, but that friend says, "Let me show you my brand new BMW." Or maybe you're excited about having gotten a nice little sapphire bracelet, and then that friend says, "Oh, that's nice, but look at my brand new tennis bracelet that's loaded with giant diamonds." Well, sometimes those things happen by accident, and the other person doesn't have any idea how it makes you feel, but it certainly shuts down your story. It shuts off that voice. The attention has switched. It's now on the other person. Well, sometimes I think that's a mistake that people like me, white liberals, often make in discussions about anti-racism, the issues that are sweeping our country today. There's a term called white privilege, which has been part of this ongoing discussion. Many people say, "I don't have white privilege. I don't have any privilege. My family was poor. We had to work very hard for what we had. My family were Irish immigrants. Do you have any idea how they were treated when they came to our country?" Well, the term white privilege isn't intended to negate any of that, but it does suggest that the barriers that we've had in our life aren't rooted in the color of our skin. And so sometimes these sorts of things in this dialogue shut us down. They create discussions that take us away from the real issues at hand. You know, we're all part of the environment, the time, the place, the people in which we've grown up and lived our lives. And sometimes we have absorbed little lessons that are embedded in our minds and hearts somewhere. Sometimes we don't even know that we have them or that they've affected us or the way we think. Now, I have to confess that I grew up in a neighborhood where there was the occasional racist joke. I had a neighbor who was upset when a black family visited an open house thinking about buying a house on our street. She was afraid that the property values would go down. These kinds of things make a difference, and they're hidden in our minds in various ways, and we never know how they might affect the way we think or the way we consider what's going on. Now, my friends of color have certainly had far too many opportunities to absorb the kinds of messages that have sent a less than message to them. Somehow, they've gotten the message, sometimes it's a very direct message and a racist message, that their lives somehow are less valuable, their minds are less sharp, somehow they're less than. And I know many a black parent who has gone to extraordinary efforts to make sure that they raise their children in ways to counterbalance the stereotypes that they know are out there. They want their children to have a fair chance at life, a fair chance at learning, a fair chance at jobs, all to overcome stereotypes that many times we don't even know that we're holding. Some of us would like to believe that we're colorblind, but there's really no such thing as that. Research has clearly shown us that we all carry inherent biases. In fact, there are countless online tests that you can take to better explore what some of your biases might be. In my family, when we talked about the talk, it was about the birds and the bees. In families of African children, the talk is about how to respond when you have encounters with the police. And I have friends who are mothers of black sons in particular, who have a deep-seated fear of what could go wrong in an encounter with a law enforcement officer. That's not okay. The recent deaths of Black men and women, George Floyd, they've raised awareness across the entire country about what really happens to be walking in Black skin. Right now in Rochester, the home of our ABC region, the city is actively exploring and protesting over the death of a Black man named Daniel Prude. Many of our pastors and our sister churches are involved in discussions about police reform. Now, I have many relatives who have been in law enforcement. It is a hard job, make no mistake, but there are plenty of people who should not be wearing the uniform. And we need to see that the system changes. You know, systemic racism pervades every part of our lives. And if you don't want to believe the anecdotal stories about the hardships that some of our friends of color have experienced, then take a look at the real research. If you want to know about racial injustice in the housing area, read the book Color of Law. It will explain exactly how it's embedded in our legal system. If you don't believe there are problems of racial imbalances in our criminal justice system, then read The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander, a Columbus resident, a New York Times columnist. And there's plenty of statistical studies that clearly lay out racial disparities when it comes to healthcare outcomes, education, jobs, the economy. They're not coincidences. This is what systemic racism means, and we are a part of it. This is a problem of white America. This is a problem we need to solve. It's not a problem for our friends of color. We need to own it, and we need to do something about it. You know, it's not up to our friends of color to walk us through this battle, to take time to educate us, answer our silly questions, and make us feel like we're good people by responding to this crisis. This is something we must do because we love God, and working for justice is doing God's work. Black Lives Matter is a phrase that has made many people uneasy. But unfortunately, it doesn't always feel like Black Lives Matter to many in that community. You know, I had a really significant experience at University Baptist Church several years ago, and many people will remember this. Kim Kiefler Ball was our pastor, and her practice was to call children to the front row, the front pew, and she would do a children's time. And anyone who does a children's moment during worship is a brave individual because you never know what children are going to say. And her son, a lovely little white boy named John, was in the middle of the row with his arm around his buddy at church, Marissa, a beautiful, precious little Black girl that we all adored. And this happened to be the weekend of the Martin Luther King Day holiday. And so Pastor Kim was reading a passage from a book. And in that book, it was talking about how Martin Luther King felt bad because he would not be able to take his daughter to a brand new amusement park, because that amusement park only admitted white people. And then out of nowhere, little Marissa raised her hand and she said, "Why do white people hate Black people?" There was a gasp throughout the entire sanctuary. It was like time stood still, and we looked at each other. There were tears and a real sense of relief that we didn't have to handle that question. Now, I don't even remember what Pastor Kim said that day. But the fact that a little girl, a precious, beloved child of our congregation, has questions about that because of messages that she has received as a child made my heart ache. And these recent tragedies dealing with the loss of Black lives truly breaks my heart. I know that it creates all kinds of feelings for my friends of color. Anger, fear, hopelessness, despair. I don't know what it's like to walk around as a person of color. I don't know the ways they try to overcome stereotypes just in an effort to succeed. But I offer my deep apologies to my friends of color for all of those pains. I also offer my apologies because learning about the statistics of systemic racism is nothing new to me. I knew it. I knew it was bad. And yet, I did precious little. In the parable of the Good Samaritan, I've kind of been like that Jewish priest and the Levite who walk over the body of the injured man and did nothing. And it took a Samaritan, a lowly Samaritan, to actually show the world how to live for love and justice. So for that, I am sorry. I'm deeply sorry. But I commit to be more aware and more awoke. I commit to educate myself. I have much to learn. And I want to do it. I want to read books. I want to participate in online trainings. I want to know more so I can do better. I also commit to my friends of color that in addition to learning, I'm going to talk less and listen more. I don't want to be a person who is a one-upper and interrupts in the stories, which are chances to learn from people who have different perspectives and different experiences than my own. I want to learn those experiences. I want to learn that wisdom. And I want to understand. I want to be a better ally. And I want to take action. I want to be on these lines that are fighting for and working for a better America. I want to help push our nation over the line so that the term equality no longer sounds like a threat to some. You know, it's not going to be easy. It's not going to be quick. And it's not always going to be comfortable. I'm going to make mistakes. But I'm going to listen. I'm going to learn. And I'm going to offer love to all of God's children. You know, I recently read that not all who fight racism are Christians, but all Christians must fight racism. It is the kind of thing that Jesus taught us to do. My favorite passage is from Micah. What does the Lord require of you but to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God? Do justice. It requires action. Love kindness. Acting always in the spirit of a loving God. Showing it to others. And walk humbly. Knowing there is lots to learn. Walk humbly. Praying to God for wisdom and guidance and even forgiveness. Walk humbly as we attempt to be anti-racist. So that all of God's children will know that in every part of our lives, we desire for them the same thing we desire for our families. So please hear my confession and please hold me to my commitment, because together I think we can all do God's work as we think about and commit ourselves to these activities on Anti-Racism Sunday. Amen.
Spirit in this place. children pray. Send us power, send us grace. Lord, listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray.
Everyone, please join me in the prayers of the people. Gracious and loving God, we enter into our time of prayer this Anti-Racism Sunday with a hunger and a thirst for justice. We seek to see your kingdom here on earth for all of your children. God, we acknowledge that many times we fall short of your glory in our actions, and perhaps more importantly, in our inactions. We pray, O God, that you would give each of us the strength to stand up to racism and injustice in all its forms, and to soften our hearts to help us realize our own biases and prejudices. Through this, we might begin to bring about your kingdom here on earth. We pray for the families of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Trayvon Martin, Philando Castile, and so many more of your children whose lives were claimed way too early by the darkness of racism and hate. We also pray for the family of Daniel Prude and all the people in Rochester, UBC's home region, dealing with yet another avoidable tragedy. God, we ask you bring those people comfort and help bring about the change we are all longing to see. Lastly, Lord, we have prayer requests from those among our UBC family. Pat would like to pray for Isaac, who is undergoing surgery this week on September 23rd, and Leslie would like to pray for her friend Chris as she transitions to a new home and better medical care. For all of these prayers, we say together in one voice, loving God, hear our prayer. For it is in your Son's name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen.
Hello, friends. Thank you for joining us for this time of worship. And I add my welcome to the welcomes that have been given earlier in this service and that will be given a bit later. Again, I'm so glad that you have joined us for this time of worship. This is the time in the service where we turn our attention to the offering that we will make to God through the University Baptist Church. Since we are worshiping virtually, we will not actually collect an offering at this time, but we will consider the kind of offering that we will make to God through the University Baptist Church. There are two primary ways that you can get your offering to the church. The first of these is simply to mail a check to the church's physical address. The office manager keeps office hours most weeks, Tuesday through Friday, 8 a.m. to noon, and she'll be there to process your offering. And the physical address is 50 West Lane Avenue, Columbus, 43201. A second way that you can make an offering is to go to the church's homepage, and that address is www.ubccolumbus.org. And you can scroll a little more than halfway down, and you'll see a button there that you can click, and that will take you to the portal, and then you'll be able to process your offering. Again, that website address is www.ubccolumbus.org. Now, as we turn to consider the kind of offering that we will make to God through the University Baptist Church, I ask that you hear this call to offering. God has given us life. God has made every child a holy child. May we open our hearts now and give generously to God and to God's church for the sake of the children who are our future. Please bow with me for prayer. Generous God, our lives are renewed as we remember your goodness. You have made us in your image and placed in our hearts the memory of your love made flesh in Jesus Christ. That memory calls us to give and to embrace your world as we offer these gifts. May our lives invested through these offerings create a new reality and extend your grace in remembrance of Jesus, in whose name we offer this prayer. Amen.
Justice is a complex issue, and you may have feelings and opinions very different from mine. In fact, there are many that have a multitude of perspectives. Mine aren't the only one. Did I come off as being too preachy? Did I come off as being not firm enough? Did I say the wrong thing? And if I did, I am sorry. Please call me. I want to listen and I want to learn. But if we're all too afraid to say something because we're afraid that we're going to say the wrong thing, then nothing will change. You know, here at UBC, even when I say the exact wrong thing, our loving congregation continues to make me feel loved and embraced and supported as I continue to grow in my spiritual journey. You'll have that experience too. So don't be afraid to reach out and have discussions. You'll experience that same kind of support from our church family. We're going to post a lot of resources online. There are some wonderful materials from Ohio State, the Council of Churches, and our own Rochester region is going to be doing a whole week-long look at various issues surrounding racial justice. If you're interested in getting more involved, please let me know. There's a lot of work to be done, and I'd enjoy talking with how we, within our church, can stand on the shoulders of others before us who have done a lot of witnessing and advocacy for justice in our community and indeed around the world. You know, we just lost Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. Before she joined the U.S. Supreme Court, she was a terrific advocate on women's issues. She said wherever there are decisions being made, women should be there. She's right. But not only should women be there, but so should people of color. And so we have work to do to make sure that we have full inclusion. So let us pray that people, that big, beautifully diverse family of God's children that we are a part of, may they all know that they matter. And may they all feel like justice is flowing around them like water. May we have the energy, the wisdom, and the confidence to do justice. Let us love kindness and reflect God's abundant love. And may we walk humbly with God, knowing our Lord will be with us on this journey, scooping us up when we make mistakes and cheering us on when we do the holy work of fighting for justice and shalom. In his loving name, we pray. Amen. Go in peace.
Go now in peace, go now in peace. In the love of God surround you everywhere. Go now in peace, go.